So I can relate to that 10 years ago when I ran for the assembly. And that was the first race where I got to represent Antioch, because I had been on the Concord City Council and then on the Board of Supervisors, but I didn't represent Antioch. And I walked every precinct in Antioch because I had to win Antioch in order to win the assembly race. I started out 7 percentage points behind my opponent, and I ended up winning by 12 or 15, and I won in Antioch. And it was a great experience, because this is a great city with, as all of you know who live here and represent it, many challenges, the challenges that have emerged in an unpredictable fashion, along with a lot of wonderful things over the last 20 years. And it continues to change. So I've been really thrilled to represent Antioch. I've represented all of it in the Assembly, all of it in my two terms in the State Senate, and now I represent about 25% of it. So you're sitting in the 11th Assembly District, and I share it with a good friend and a very capable member of Congress, Jerry McNerney. So I'm thrilled to be here. I'm thrilled to see so many friends. Wade, I'm really thrilled to have him here, somebody who really understands some of the tensions in this country right now, having been in law enforcement and having been passionate about disadvantaged communities and communities of color. I've seen him interact between those two, sometimes it seems contradictory, but they shouldn't be contradictory forces in our national life. And if we're ever going to start to develop a healthier, better, more honest relationship with race in America, Wade is the type of person that we want on the city council and as mayor of a city like Antioch. So thank you for being here. It was a wonderful thing to be part of. and see the joy in his family, but see the joy of the extended community that you were a member of the board, and we were demonstrating very much needed diversity on that board of supervisors, and you've done a great job on the time you've been on. He's heard it a million times, but the first day when he was on, Janice walks over to me, walks up, and does the index finger, and goes, she says to me, she says, stay away from my husband. So I had a reputation for getting bored during board meetings and sort of scooting over to the people who sat on either side of me, and people would see it on TV, and sometimes my juvenile sense of humor. So I used to do that to Charles and Cancelillo. So the first day he came up, Janice said, stay away from my husband. I don't want you goofing around with him on TV. I did say, though, you know, people can take that different ways. So, I've been in Congress now for almost 2 years, replacing George Miller, who represented this area, along with Ellen Tauscher and others, for 40 years. When I come down to Antioch, I always go by Waldy Plaza, because before George Miller, there was another amazing member of Congress, an amazing member of the state legislature, Jerry Waldy, who represented this area, was from Antioch, passed away just a few years ago. In my new district office, his son worked for the state assembly, he's now retired, but I had become friends with Jerry and the family, and when I got elected to Congress, the family said, we want you to have Jerry's desk that he had when he was in Congress in your district office. He was an extraordinary man, principal. He was the majority leader for some period of time in the assembly before he went to Congress. And he and a Republican actually brought the impeachment papers, the proceedings, to the House Judiciary Committee against Richard Nixon. So this area has had years and years of very engaged, ethical, passionate representatives. So for me to follow in those very large shoes, and some of you have heard this story, everybody, whenever I told anybody who I was following in Congress, it was always the same. You've got big shoes to fill. So George does, he has about a size 28 So it's physically impossible. But the worst was when a freshman class, and there were only 17 freshman Democrats, went to the White House to meet the president. The president asked me, so who did you replace? I said, George Miller. And he goes, oh, you've got big shoes to fill. So, the difficulty being in Congress right now is that the institution is dysfunctional. We're going through a really difficult period in our history. For those of us who are old enough, we know we've been through this before. The civil rights movement, I'm old enough to remember black and white TVs, police officers using dogs and fire hoses in the South when President Johnson was trying to get civil rights legislation through before and after those episodes. We're going through a really unfortunate, we went through an unfortunate recession, which Antioch was hit very hard by because of the housing market. And I heard that when I was walking precincts in the Keep area in the legislature and Congress, but particularly during that period of the legislature, I was author of what became a bigger bill, but was a very significant bill about foreclosures. This started to change how we handled that. So my bill required one per point of contact. So when you needed to refinance your mortgage, you're in trouble, you'd call the banks and the servers, and you'd get a different person every day. And it turns out they actually were rewarded for that because they got, every time they contacted somebody, the federal government gave them a reimbursement. So we changed that to say you had to have one point of contact. We also changed that to say you have to have a specific point where you start the process, and when you finish it, because people would be on this endlessly, and they never find out. And then the other part was dual tracking, where they'd be modifying loans, but at the same time, without telling you, they'd start the eviction process. So part of the process is you give us one person, you give us a prescribed period of time, and then you tell them, based on criteria that we give you a framework for, whether they qualify for being staying in their home or whether they need to move on with their life, because they don't. So that was basically, my interest in that came from, largely from Antioch, from dealing with constituents who, the worst story was a gentleman who was under hospice care who had less than 30 days to live. He had terminal cancer, and B of A, I'm sorry to mention the name of the bank, was going to throw him out of the house. So So we called him and said that I was going to chain myself to the front door. Strangely enough, they modified it. When they sent the letter, it was great. They said they thanked U.S. Senator Mark DeSaulnier's. I don't have the heart to tell him after all that. I'm a state senator. But that's an example of how this community has affected me, and I've tried to respond to it. And I think it's part of what we're struggling with in this country. So we need to find out why wages are stagnant, why people are disaffected, why Bernie Sanders was right. Why Donald Trump, strangely enough, has hit the resonant with some of these people, other than obvious racism in his campaign. Why is it that people are disaffected? So I'm on the Labor Committee. Myself and three colleagues are going to start going around the country to compile from experts, from business owners, and from labor unions, starting at UC Berkeley, to have them tell us what's the future of wage, work, and labor. You need to have a labor movement, whether it's unionized people or other representations. Experts tell us you have to have institutions that balance the interests of workers and the interests of investors. And there's nothing wrong with investment, but right now they're way out of whack. So this recovery, if you have investments, it's been a pretty good recovery. There's nothing wrong with getting your return on investment. But for wage holders, their wages have been stagnant since the 70s. So we need to find out for what our kids and our grandkids, what are we going to train them for? What are the jobs of the future? Because manufacturing is different than it was when this was a thriving port, when Pittsburgh and Martinez were thriving ports. So we're going to do that and see what we can do about that. And then lastly, mostly because of Chanel, we're going to start a conversation that we'd love you to be part of about although I will try in Congress, but what we can do about what happens in Ferguson and Milwaukee and in other parts of the country, Charleston. We can do here. We can make sure that we have an honest conversation with everybody who wants to be part of it about our relationships with one another as human beings and how that trumps every tribe we're from or our ethnicity or our gender. So we're going to start a conversation with the community college district that we've been working with Health and Benjamin with about going out, having an honest conversation, and inviting people like Michelle Alexander, if any of you are familiar with her, a tremendous book called The New Jim Crow. I'm going to get John Lewis, my colleague, to come out to one of these meetings and just talk about, honestly, how do we avoid these situations where there's clearly racial prejudice, and how do we make sure that in our community, we're not afraid of talking about it, and we're not afraid of accepting the challenges, and go where to make sure that this place, our community, as good as it is, gets better and better.